Davis, your host of the Untold Miracles podcast. And today I am so excited. I have a really good friend and someone I really admire on the podcast. He competed last year on America's Got Talent and he made it to the semifinals and his voice inspired the world. And he is a Children's Miracle Network Hospitals champion. He's 17 years old. He's from Long Island. And I also want to introduce his amazing mother. Please welcome to the podcast, Christian Guardino and Beth Guardino.
Hey, how are you guys?
Good. Hey, Christian and Beth, thank you so much for taking the time to be on the podcast today because I know that so many people will be inspired by your story. You were born with a disease that impacted your eyesight. You were going blind. You really thought you would be blind for the rest of your life. But fortunately, there was a gene therapy that you were able to do, which restored your eyesight. Can you tell us about what it was like when you were younger, not having eyesight, and what it's like today?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I was actually born with a very rare retinal disease called Leber's congenital amaurosis, and LCA for short. And basically what it was it was a missing gene in your eye that caused the disease. And because you don't have that gene in your eye, you're not getting protein that your cells need for your eyes to see. So because you're not getting that protein, your cells are, you know, slowly dying off over time. And that's what causes the blindness.
And what was that like as a kid not being able to see things and being legally blind?
Growing up, I didn't really notice that I had a disease or I had an issue. I thought that my eyes were normal until maybe about 5 or 6 years old when, you know, it'd become around like dusk time and I couldn't see at all. Like I'd be completely blind and I'd have to go inside and sit with my parents. So I think that's when I was like really starting to notice a difference. And I said, Ma, why can't I play outside and all the other kids can? Because they were still outside having fun playing. I didn't know why I couldn't do that because I thought what I had was normal eyesight, you know, so it was kind of like, I didn't really understand that there was something wrong with my eyes.
So Beth, I would love for you to tell us how Facebook actually helped you find the answer to this for Christian.
I mean, I have to say for the first 11 years or so of Christian's life with this disease, we were really alone. We didn't know anyone else, even that had a child that was legally blind or so visually impaired. And this particular disease is so rare. It only affects one in every 100,000 births. And at the time, they still didn't know much about LCA and even what genes were causing it. So despite having the genetic testing, they were not even able to identify the gene, you know, when he was diagnosed. We were also misinformed. We were told that he had the type of LCA that would either remain stable or slightly improve with age. And that was about when he was 6 and 9 months old when he was being diagnosed. So once we started to see a decline in his vision, he was about 10 and 11, I was starting to see some decline, and it really made me nervous. And, you know, at that time, thank God we had computers in our homes and, you know, the internet was raging and social media was you know, huge. So for some reason, one day I decided to do a search on Facebook, of all things, and I typed in LCA, and I came across a support group. And my initial reaction was, no, there's no way that this is our LCA. But investigating further, it was. And I was completely floored to finally be in touch with some other families that were experiencing what we were experiencing. And in doing so, we had found out that every 2 years they were doing LCA family conferences. And I think it was the following week, we wound up with a packet in the mail, and we were signing up for our first LCA family conference at in Philadelphia. And that was where we were able to get him retested and at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, and that was what started our journey.
Well, tell us about the miracle workers, the husband and wife that developed this gene therapy program, which essentially restored Christian's sight.
Oh, my goodness. Dr. Jean Bennett and Dr. Albert McGuire. Dr. Jean Bennett is actually the research scientist behind the gene therapy. You know, she had some colleagues that worked with her, and her and her husband's life's work was to find treatments for these inherited retinal diseases and for blindness. And she was able to, in her lab, she was able to clone the RPE65 gene, which is the only gene at that time that had gone to human trials for gene therapy. So she was able to clone the gene, and as Christian said, they were able to place it into a safe virus, and that virus's job is to transport it, to be the vector, and bring it to where it was missing in the retina. She pretty much dedicated her life's work to that, and Dr. McGuire is the surgeon. So he was the doctor that actually implanted the reagent into Christian's eyes and performed the surgeries. And they are just the most incredible human beings. Sorry, I'm getting teary. They're just incredible. They're humble. They are, you see the joy that they are getting out of seeing the results of their life's work. And, you know, it's a blessing for us too to see them have the satisfaction. I mean, I know there's not many scientists and physicians out there that actually get to see their life's work come to be a reality. So it's a blessing in so many ways.
Christian, tell me about your experience testifying at Capitol Hill about this therapy program, and what were the results from that?
Well, when we were asked to testify in front of the FDA, I was a little nervous because it's the FDA, and I don't consider myself a good speech giver. I was really just honored to have the opportunity to go up and just be a small part of the gene therapy and just share my experience with it. Just so happy that, you know, the FDA approved the gene therapy, and it's just incredible to think that people who desperately need this treatment are going to be able to get it.
And I love, Christian, that with your singing, you now have a platform to really help others that are going through difficult challenges. And what advice do you give to people who may be kids treated at a children's hospital right now, or an adult that's just going through some difficult times and they really are discouraged and almost ready to give up? What would you say to them?
Don't let a disease or disability hold you back from achieving greatness, because look at me. I didn't think I was going to ever make it to where I am now. So, and I couldn't have done it without just believing in myself and you know, trusting that everything would be okay and just going for my dreams regardless of my eye disease.
I hear or read about that you were actually touched by music when you were like 5 months old. When Twinkle Twinkle Little Star came on, you actually reacted to the music. I want to know when your love of music really began and what your dreams were when you were little.
I feel like my love of music began pretty much as soon as I was born. I think I always had that kind of spark or passion for music. My dream when I was little was pretty much my dream now, which is to become a recording artist or just be a singer and get music out there and have people relate to what I'm saying. And I just want to put my feeling and soul out there.
So I want to go back to last year, and you walk onto the stage for America's Got Talent, and you're performing in front of millions and millions of people. I want to know what it was like walking on stage singing your first song.
Oh, wow. Well, walking onto that stage knowing that I was in front of Howie Mandel, Heidi Klum, Mel B, and Simon Cowell, just such talented, incredible people. I was pretty nervous and a little scared, because I know Simon was going to tell me how it is, whether I liked it or not. So I was really just a little nervous. But when I got on that stage, everything just kind of left me, all the nerves, all the, you know, just all the thoughts in my head, and I could only think of music and just giving it my all and showing these people that music is what I love and music is what I want to do for my life.
Well, I want to know what it felt like when you were on stage and Howie gave you the golden buzzer, which meant that you automatically went to the semifinals. What did that feel like in that moment?
As soon as you hit that golden buzzer, the only thought that was running through my head was, what the heck just happened?
Were you crying? Were your mom and dad crying? Like, what was it like?
Yeah, I felt the tears coming. You know, it was beautiful. My mom ran out, and, you know, it was just an incredible moment. And Howie came up on stage, and I bear hugged him. I just gave him the biggest bear. I didn't care. I just went. I really went for it. I did not care. I was, boom, give him a huge bear hug. It was just insane just to think about that I, you know, made it that far.
Well, I was at your performance for the semifinals, and I got to actually meet you. After the show, we were at a restaurant and I got introduced to you and your amazing mom. And I just was so blown away, Christian, by your voice. Every time I listen to one of your videos, I get the chills because God has given you such a big talent. And I love how you're using it to inspire other people. What do you want people to take away from your music and your voice and your message?
I want to show people that this is what I do, and this is what I'm meant to do, and you know, that I just want people to feel soul through my music, and I want to, if I can help just one person who's having a bad day and make them feel better, I think I've achieved so much.
Well, I know that you're definitely doing that, and I really think that you're inspiring people to have hope and to have faith and to know that really anything is possible, because if you experience those challenging times and we're able to come out on the other side, that can happen to anyone that is listening to the podcast. I know that you've had some really cool experiences since your experience on AGT, and I would like for you to share some of those moments with us and maybe one of your most favorite moments post AGT.
That's tough because I've had so many incredible opportunities since AGT, but I think if I had to pick my favorite, it would probably be working with the Sasha Scarbeck. He's written so many incredible songs. He's written You're Beautiful by James Blunt. He's written A Wrecking Ball. And he's just such an incredible, talented person. And being in the studio with him and just working on a song, it was just absolutely incredible. And I was an honor just to share the studio with him and work with him and share my ideas with the song and just, it was incredible. And the song is really great. I can't wait for everybody to hear the song.
Tell me what it was like to perform in front of Michelle Obama.
Oh, wow. So, yeah, that was about a year and a half ago.
Uh-huh.
It was for the Partnership for a Healthy America, and my mom knows the name for all of my events that I've ever done. It's really scary how she remembers everything. But just being there and being able to perform with Jordan Sparks was kind of insane. I freaked out a little bit because it was Jordan Sparks. And I sang No Air with Jordan, and it just was so cool to share a stage with somebody as big as Jordan Sparks. And her talent is insane. Her voice is incredible.
She's a big supporter of ours. And that's so cool that you were able to do sing with her. I can't even imagine what that would be like.
It's pretty insane. She's incredible. She's an incredible person. One of the sweetest people I've ever met. And she is so talented. She's just one of the nicest people I've ever met. And being there in D.C. and just getting that opportunity is so incredible.
If you could do a collaboration with anyone, Christian, who would that be?
Kendrick Lamar.
He's a little hot right now. That would be very cool to do a collaboration. Tell me who you most look up to in life.
I look up to a lot of people. Like, as an artist, I think my top artist right now because I've just been so incredibly just taken by his music, and just his incredible message that comes from his music. I think Kendrick Lamar, yeah, I look up to him so much, and just, he's such a role model to me, because even though I'm not a rapper, his music and his meaning and his soul is something I want to translate into my own music. You know, I want to have soul, and I want my message to mean something to the world. You know what I'm saying?
Yes. What person in your life do you think has been the biggest miracle worker?
That would definitely be my parents.
And why is that?
I'm here today, and I am the person that I am because of my parents. Every opportunity that I've had, everything that I've gone through, they've been there by at my corner, always supporting me. So they're my biggest miracle workers.
What do you think is the biggest lesson that they've taught you?
Never, ever change myself for anybody or anything. Stay true to myself and to the people around me. Never change and never forget where I came from.
Christian, do you have a motto that you like to live by?
Yeah, I think that's my motto. Never forget who I am and never change for anybody. Never forget where I came from.
That's such good advice, especially like with social media nowadays and everybody trying to impress people and be maybe someone they're not. That is amazing, amazing advice. Are there any miracle kids that you've met along the way while you've had treatment at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia or while being a champion that have inspired you?
Nate, he has such an incredible resilience, and he's such an incredible kid, and I can't even imagine, you know, what he's going through or what his parents are going through, and just how he fights and he stays so strong through what he has. He's just in such an incredible person to not only be around. The kid is absolutely hilarious. But he's one of the kindest souls I've ever met.
And we're talking about Nate Farrell. He is our champion, and he lives in Florida, and he has mitochondrial disease. And unfortunately, this disease is not great, and it affects the mitochondria. He is hooked to oxygen at all times, but he would never know, like you said, Christian, like he doesn't let this disease hold him back. And he truly shows us really how to live our life and stay positive and be kind and loving to everyone. But really, Christian, that's what you do for me. I watched you interact with all of our champion children in Salt Lake City a couple weeks ago. And you're 17, and a lot of the kids are 7 and 8 and 11 and younger. And you were so loving and kind, and you got down on their level, and you made each one of them feel like they were the most important person that you knew. That's a talent. That's a skill. And it wasn't acting, Christian. It was you being you. It was you showing them that you care about them and that you're there for them and that you listen and that they are seen and that they are heard by you. So I just really want to acknowledge you for the outstanding human being that you are.
Thank you so, so much. And you know what it is? I think mentally it's because I am their age. Yeah, I'm a big child.
Oh, that is true.
Ma, you know it's true, Mom.
Mom, do you have anything to say about the biggest miracle in Christian's life or the biggest miracle?
Going from, you know, not knowing if Christian would ever even see my face to seeing him turn to us in a dimly lit room and recognize that we were sitting there, all the accomplishments. And I really truly believe that because of the gene therapy and his gain of vision, it's helped him so much more with his confidence and his stage presence and, you know, getting up there on that stage in front of Simon Cowell, which was a huge dream of his since he was little. I remember him telling me, Mommy, I have to sing for Simon. And to see that actually not only come to be, but that he was able to go so far and touch so many people. It's like watching his life come full circle. But I have to say, the biggest, most touching reward for me is that he and even myself were being contacted from people that were just like we were. in the dark, you know, for so many years and alone in this and didn't have the resources or know where to turn for them. And we're now able to help them get to the proper channels that they need to get to. So for me, that is the biggest miracle in all of this. And I think it's God's biggest plan in all of this.
Mm.
Christian's life, I really truly believe in my heart, as difficult as things were and as scary as things were, God had a plan this whole time. And to me, it was exactly what's happening now, is that he's able to share his inspiration and his gift, and it's now able to bless others. And that's something that I always tell him, you know, this gift is something that, yes, you have this talent, but it's lent to you by God, and it's something that you're supposed to use for his glory.
Mm.
And I really truly believe that he's doing that.
Wow.
You know, so that's my biggest miracle in all of this.
Well, Christian, I close out the podcast with this question. If there were three miracles that you could create in the world today, what would that be for you?
Three miracles that I could create. That's puffy.
And it can be anything. Believe me, I've kind of heard it all. Some have been like Dr. J wanted to improve his golf game. And there's been some really, you know, intense miracles. But yeah, what would it look like for you if there could be three miracles, anything?
I think it'd be a miracle to just be able to get music out there and just be able to help people and reach people through my music. So that would be one.
Which you're already doing, by the way.
Thank you. I have two would be, I want to, like, get rid of things like racism or prejudice.
Mm.
And just stop completely, just forget it exists. Because I feel like if we do that, then, you know, I don't want to categorize people.
Mm-hmm.
I know you by your name. Mm. I don't know you by your skin color or disability or anything like that.
Mm.
I know you by your name, and the person that you are represents you.
Wow.
The third miracle would be to make sure this treatment is given to everybody who needs it.
Mm.
This gene therapy.
I really want to thank you and your amazing mama, Beth, and acknowledge you for how much you bless the planet just by being here. You truly are a miracle. You truly inspire everyone around you who knows you. And I just want to thank you for being a champion. We're so grateful that you are helping us raise funds and awareness for Children's Miracle Network hospitals. We treat 10 million kids each year at 170 children's hospitals, and it's champion kids like you who tell their stories that help people want to get involved and donate. And I can't wait to see you during Children's Hospitals Week.
I can't wait. That's going to be loads of fun.
Thanks for tuning in to Christian's podcast episode. We are so grateful to have him as a champion, and we're very grateful to have Delta as a sponsor of our Champions Program and Children's Hospitals Week. And I'm so excited to introduce you to Greg Kennedy, the Senior Vice President of Airport Operations at Delta. He's also been on the Board of Governors at Children's Miracle Network Hospitals for over 13 years. Mr. Greg Kennedy, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks, Kelly. It's great to be here today.
Well, we are so grateful for Delta's support of Children's Miracle Network Hospitals. You are actually celebrating your 20th year of support. Us. Why is CMN Hospital such an important cause to Delta?
That's a great question, Kelly. And yes, thank you. We're very excited to be celebrating our 20th anniversary this year. As the official airline partner, I would say there are several reasons we support CMN Hospitals, starting with the fact that wellness is one of Delta's global pillars. And then I would add that CMN Hospitals touch the lives of Delta employees and customers where we live and work. You know, it's really all about the kids, and we have lots of kids who are extended members of the Delta family. So naturally, it provides our employees a unique opportunity to give back and volunteer right in their own community.
For so many years, you guys have been raising millions of dollars, and we're so grateful because those millions of dollars help save so many kids' lives. I know that you are a miracle dad yourself. Would you mind telling your personal story?
Sure. Yes, I'm very proud to be a miracle dad. But let me just say before I tell the story that my wife does a much better job.
I'm sure you'll do great.
20 years ago, our oldest daughter, Megan, ended up spending several weeks at Eggleston's Children's Hospital here in Atlanta. She was initially diagnosed with the flu and sent home by the doctor to rest and that she would get well. Well, that evening, things got worse. She became more and more sick, and she didn't sleep at all through the night, struggled, really sensitive to touch. She couldn't even put a sheet on her because it hurt her so bad. So my wife, Pam, noticed that there were small spots of blood under Megan's skin where blood vessels had burst, and like the eyelid and behind the knee and under the arm. And so, early that morning, she rushed her back to the doctor's office, and the doctor took one look at her and realized that she needed to get to the hospital immediately and indicated it would be faster for Pam to drive rather than wait for an ambulance. So, in a, one of those crazy storms in Atlanta, my wife takes off with Megan in the back towards the hospital. And long story short, she made it to the hospital just in time. Megan was really, she was losing consciousness. Thankfully, the wonderful doctors and nurses,
You're fine.
The doctors and nurses were ready for them and rushed her away while the waiting began. And it's funny how sensitive this is even 20 years later, but she was diagnosed with spinal bacterial meningitis, knew nothing about at the time. You know, I really can't say enough about the doctors and nurses at Eggleston's. They perform miracles. And, what was amazing about it as we look back is how they treated us like we were the only parents there. Our miracle is Megan. We were very fortunate. Megan completely healed thanks to the great work by Eggleston's. She now has four beautiful, healthy kids and is doing great. So she's definitely our miracle child.
How old was Megan when this happened to her?
She was 10 years old.
You never want to hear the word meningitis. I mean, that I can't even imagine processing that and how that must have felt.
It was pretty bleak from the outset, but great things happen.
Wow. As a parent, how did you get through that incredibly challenging time watching your child rely on the care of the children's hospital, knowing there was nothing you could do?
Good question, because we talk about that all the time. There were several things that really got us through. First and foremost, it was faith and prayer and pleading with the Lord to perform a miracle and help us. But we also knew that it was going to take the expertise and the tender, loving care of the doctors and nurses at Eggleston's, which they did an amazing work. And then finally, just the love and support of our families and friends, family members and friends who were there throughout the entire ordeal. And what we learned really out of that, once it was all said and done, was that Pam and I had really committed ourselves at that time that we would do whatever we could from that time forward to help support families in the same situation, and even children's hospitals by volunteering and doing whatever we could to raise funds to help support the cause for caring for kids.
Aside from your own experience, Greg, is there a particular child you've met over the past 20 years that's inspired you?
Now, that is a tough question.
Because you've met a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I could name one or identify just one, because honestly, I love every one of them. I mean, I think every child I've met over the years has inspired me and really our great company, Delta Airlines, to continue supporting CMN hospitals and my family. We've just enjoyed every single moment with them, and they when we're in their presence, they inspire us to come back and just to work hard to raise more funds and to do whatever we can to help. So I would hate to name one, because there's so many wonderful miracle kids and children that we have just fallen in love with. So I'll leave it at that I think every one of them have inspired me.
I do want to thank you, Greg, and acknowledge you for your huge heart and everything that you've done with your leadership to help raise millions of dollars for Children's Miracle Network Hospitals. We are so grateful for your sponsorship of Children's Hospitals Week, of our Champions program, and we really would not be doing what we are today without the support of Delta.
Well, thank you, Kelly. It's really a blessing for us. I think we get more out of it than the hospitals and the kids just by having the opportunity to help support and give back to them.
And we really look forward to many more years of a beautiful partnership with Delta.
Me too. Thanks a lot, Kelly.